song from West Side
Story. You could hear me? That was horrible. I usually... All right, ready? Folks, you're listening to the Wrecking Crew Comedy Podcast with Vito D'Amico, and the one and only co-host, Mykeru, is here with us.
Right, Mykeru. Or yeah. Michael Cortese.
Or Michael Cortese.
Or still Mykeru.
No, I want to call it... I thought it was Corleone.
No. I'm just putting it out there, you know, because, you know, YouTube handed over my personal information to some of the scummiest people on the planet.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
I like to get out there and ruin their fun as much as I can.
Yeah, but I liked it. I liked it when it was kind of like a mysterious kind of thing. So, yeah, that's over. So that's all done for
yeah,
you.
Yeah, that's done.
That's done. This, the Mask of Zorro. You ever see the Mask of Zorro, the gay blade?
Yes.
All right, just wondering. Our guest for tonight is I listen to his show all the time. I really say that, and I lie to most of the people I talk to when I say that. But with this person, I really do watch his show. It's Positively Godless, and it's with Scott Lawrence. He's one of the three that I believe run the show. Hey, Scott, how are you tonight?
I'm well. Thank you for having me on. I appreciate it.
No problem. Listen, how did you come up with the... Anyways, I don't want to already start off badly, but congratulations on your new job. You are the lifeguard of a crocodile farm, and you're fully...
I have...
Benefits and everything. That is fantastic. Congratulations on your job. I saw that. I don't know if you want to tell people, but...
Sure. It's not a big deal. My main job, I do financial and credit analysis is my full-time job. It's a part-time job over at Paisley Park Studios, Prince's Studios. I've been a patron of that place since 1994.
And what is that?
So Paisley Park?
Yeah.
That is a full-fledged recording studio and rehearsal complex. Where, you know, Fine Young Cannibals are recorded there. Any Prince album that is post Sign of the Times has been recorded there. The Get Off video was shot there, so it's a huge soundstage. You know, you're looking at 65,000 square feet of just Prince, I guess.
65,000 square feet of nothing but
yeah.
Prince?
Oh yeah, that was his playpen. He had an apartment out there, huge soundstage that holds I think about 2,000 people.
Holy shit, I didn't know
yeah.
that. That's
beautiful.
Michael, did you know that?
No, I didn't. And that's certainly a step above, you know, what some recording artists brag about, which is, you know, they have a recording studio in the backyard in the shed.
Yeah. That's amazing. That must have cost him a fortune.
$10 million.
$10 million.
That's... In 1986.
So in 86, right now that thing would be worth, if it's that many acres, you're talking at least 10 times that. It'd be about $100 million.
And more, because
yeah.
Right now it's probably not using 1986 technology. It probably was continually upgraded.
Yeah, now it's got one computer. One fucking
right.
little computer. You walk in there. It's GarageBand.
The J-Pro. Yeah.
Yeah, it's pretty much the setup we got. Just sit here. Play the guitar.
No, I mean, the whole building is wired for sound.
That is amazing.
Meaning that if he gets an idea when he's just walking down the hallway, he can hum that idea and it's recorded.
And what do you do there? Do you tell people, like, do you go, like, if they play music, you go, that is awful or that is good? Like, what do you do?
No, since they're opening up for tours, opening day is... October 6th, so I will be one of the tour guides there.
Oh, that is awesome. You know what you need to do? The first day, honestly, get a group of people, make sure your bosses are there, take a deep breath and go, fuck it, and walk away.
I don't know if I want to jinx it yet, right?
And then
yet,
just stop
but, you know.
And go, I'm just joking, and then do the whole pro thing, and that's cool. I last time I saw a tour guide was, when you're in an airplane, the captain always, he's kind of bored going, hey, if you look at the rocks down there, it's, rocks, that's to the left. Some history happened. You could barely make out what he's saying. With the sound system that you got there, everybody, it'd be funny if they had a shitty sound system with you telling people, what? Huh? You could totally make up shit. Are you going to make up stuff? I would.
No, no, not at all. I've seen so many shows out there. The stories I have are just endless of stuff I've seen out there. It's pretty cool.
So you're a huge, huge music fan.
Yeah, I'm a musician myself, and you know, I have ridiculous things in my house that, you know, people would scratch their head over. My wife certainly does.
Well, you got something that's really freaky is you've got the God light behind you. No one can see that, but if they go to the Positive Godless show, they could see you. You've got this. It's funny because everybody's got this boring setup, and then you've got these really cool lights behind you with a nice backdrop, and it looks like the Second Coming. And it's really nice.
The Second.
No, thank you.
Don't you tell the other guys? Don't you go, guys, step it up?
No, they refuse to. And actually, you know what? We're actually doing some renovation down there. So the next couple of shows, I will actually be in an office.
Are they in the? But to me, I always thought they were in different areas. Like they would be like us. Like you would be someplace else, right? Are you guys in the same place?
No, Tyler, he's maybe 30 miles from me, and Jerry, he's in New Jersey.
Okay, and how did you meet those guys?
I met Tyler through a jam, 2009, and then I met Jerry when I used to travel for a job I had to Philadelphia, in between Minneapolis and Philadelphia. I met him actually at a karaoke bar.
That is so cool. At a what bar?
A karaoke bar or karaoke?
Okay, yeah, karaoke. I don't know what the fuck a karaoke.
Yeah, that's not the same thing as bukkake, just to make sure.
What's bukkake?
Are you kidding me?
I don't
are
know. I don't know what bukkake is.
You, a connoisseur of porn that
okay, a bukkake. The way you say it, you got to throw the bukkake. That's what it's bukkake. You just said bukkake.
I said bukkake.
Because in Italian, there's the Bugatti, right? And then there's the drink that you could have, and that is the one that tastes like licorice that you put on. What's the one you put on? You could put on fire. You could drink. You know which one I'm talking about. You put it on fire.
Sambuca.
That's it. Sambuca. Oh, it's not even close. Fuck. Not even close. Way off. Real quick, the other guy on the show. I don't know which one is
the guy with the glasses.
I don't know the one that is homosexual.
Jerry,
that's right, and he is openly what was really cool was watching you setting up a nice show to get Matt Slick to speak to J.D. Kane. I thought that was a really cool thing, and I didn't know Jerry was gay until he said I'm gay and. Started talking about he was actually sticking up for Matt Slick, and I thought he would have been like, nah, fuck Matt Slick, and no, he was actually sticking up for him, which I thought that's cool. He didn't show favoritism or anything, and that's what I thought the Positively Godless show does, is you guys are very fair.
We try to be, and our goal, especially when we have guests of, let's say, quote unquote opposition, we want to maybe bring out the other side of people, where Matt Slick has got such a bad reputation, mm-hmm. and I like the guy. You may hate him. That's fine.
Yeah.
But man, you put religion aside and you talk about other things. He's a fantastic person.
Yes,
he's funny.
I know. I put him down like crazy, and I shouldn't. But I feel like he's like and I know he's your buddy. I just feel like. He is not being honest, and I don't like the way he handles his guests sometimes. But that is cool. I did the same thing with G-Man. Everybody, they can't stand G-Man, and I wanted to do an interview with him, and I just said straight out, me and him had an argument, a really bad one, on air, and I just said to him, I just saw the way he was, and I realized that he liked wrestling, and I like wrestling too, so I thought, we got something in common. So I really wanted to talk to him. And I just said, listen, I messaged him and I said, we kind of had a little yelling match. I was wondering if we could do a show. You come on my show. I promise there will be no got you moments. There will be no yelling. There will be no setups, and there will be absolutely no religion. We're going to talk no religion. And Scott, it was one of the nicest interviews I ever had with somebody. It's just wonderful.
Yeah.
Absolutely wonderful. You know, and
we had an idea. Oh, sorry. Go on.
No, sorry. Go on. Sorry.
We had an idea of bringing G-Man back on, and this is in one of the many of G-Man meltdowns and stuff like that. I'm like, gosh, wouldn't it be cool if we bring G-Man on our show, not as G-Man, as his first and last name, and people get to know that side.
That's
that
what I
person.
Wanted. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
And he would say, yeah, my name is X, you know, and that would have been cool. He would have been maybe respected. Now, you and I and everybody else both all know that it's an act.
Yes.
Because the minute that thing hits live, he's a completely different person.
I know. And I don't want to give it out. Like, I don't want to give out his... Sorry, Michael, go ahead.
Well, Scott, you know, just because my experience with atheism and the internet goes back to ancient history. I was an op, which is like a moderator on the old EFNet atheism IRC, MIRC channel. And, you know, after a while, you must have this experience when you deal with people who jump in there and they just want to stay on script. They've either found another variation of the Kalam cosmological argument, or they read Josh McDowell's Evidence That Demands a Verdict. And, you know, it's just the same old crap. And sometimes I would sit there and, you know, you watch someone start running the script. They're almost, in that sense, the people that are evangelical that way are almost like telemarketers. You know, you can almost hear them reading the script. So the fact that you're able to get these people off script, I mean,
that's the thing that I thought, because what I noticed about any time you would get any of these, if you got a Christian on, they would get, or anybody that is considered, I tried to do this with Matt Bell, but it failed miserably. I wanted them to see a different side of the person. You know, I really did. I want people to see a different side. I don't want to see this side of just, this Mussolini-esque kind of, hey, you know, this is the way it is. This is the way. And, you know, if you're a Christian, maybe even a Christian, you'd be thinking, well, it's a little too far. Or you're thinking, oh, that's cool. But as an atheist or a non-believer, you just think, ah, this guy, you know, he's just, it's an act. Or, you know, even worse, you think that's how they are in real life. And I always thought, no, he's not like that in real life. The guy, there's no way he's like that. So I always wanted to kind of show that the person that you're seeing is not always, and I don't want to give away too much about G-Man, but it's you know, it's showtime. People, you know, it's if any time, if he were to just to sit there and do a show and just blah 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 the Bible instead of yelling and screwing around with people, nobody would care, nobody would watch. But with him being theatrical, you know, people are like, what's he gonna do next? And I totally get it. I totally get the whole heel thing in a wrestler. The reason why you watch a bad person in wrestling is you want to see them, you know, get beat up, or you want to see them say something outrageous. So I thought that was always cool about what he would do. And I think down deep inside, he's nowhere near like that. He's actually a kind person, except for Rand Campbell, who I'm going to bust his fucking head. So...
Well, I love to talk about Rand, but the thing with G-Man, it kind of reminds me of Gilbert Gottfried.
Yeah.
You know, he doesn't talk like that.
Oh, it'd be impossible. Could you, Scott, imagine? Like, I don't think Michael knows the level at which, you know, how crazy these people can behave. To do that all day.
Eons. Well, Scott, here's an observation, and let's see if you agree with this, and it has to do with... It has to do with, you know, when you're watching a debate, either a presidential debate or, you know, when Dwayne Gish would go to a college and debate some hapless member of the faculty who had no idea of the Gish Gallop and all the other little rhetorical tricks that Gish would use, you realize that people who are debating like that, when Trump and Hillary Clinton are debating, they're not trying to convince each other. they're trying to convince the people that are watching. So when you say G-Man or whomever, as soon as the recording started, he was on. It's because now he's no longer talking to you. He's talking to everyone else, hopefully the people who know the least about the subject at hand. I mean, I had this experience back in the 90s where I would argue with crackpots of all stripes, including Kennedy conspiracy theorists. And it was a common occurrence that you would debunk something on a Monday and the same person would be back repeating exactly the same thing on a Wednesday. And someone said to me, how do they do that? I mean, don't you find this frustrating? I said, no, not really, because they're not talking to me.
Yeah, and they're when G-Man is doing this, I don't think he's directly, like you ever see when he's, just say he's talking to a Hogtied anybody else. If he's talking to them, he's kind of talking past them where he knows that his viewers will watch. And I see this with a lot of people that are good at it, where they are not really talking to the person. They're talking to the people watching, where the people watching go, yeah, right on. Yeah, that's right. Fucking right. You know, that's right. What, that's how, and I totally get what you're saying, Michael. I totally get what you're saying. And I think that's something that you got to have skill to do that. You know, if you watch the debate, Scott, did you watch the debate?
Oh, gosh, yeah.
Okay, so to me, it looked like he was completely off his game. Like her sitting there smiling threw him completely off, like this fucking buzzing noise is doing to me.
Scott, is that a vibrator, not necessarily your vibrator that's going on?
It was. I was plugging my phone to the charger. I didn't have it muted. My apologies. Sorry.
What I was saying was how, if you watch the debate, Hillary looked like everybody was saying how Trump was going to kill her, going to make her look like a fool, going to do that. And I knew that Hillary, you got to remember, she's married to fucking Clinton, Bill. Bill's a stud. Bill could get away with fucking anything. Like she has heard it all from a guy. You know, it doesn't take 8 hours to get milk, Bill. You know, I mean, she knows this shit. So she knows everything a guy could throw at her. And what she did is she played off of the, I'll just sit there and smile and treat him. You know, when somebody acts like a complete jackass, the worst thing you could do is smile at them, like not take them seriously. And that's what she was doing to him. She was not taking him seriously, saying, I don't take him seriously, so why should the American people take him seriously?
Or you use the Southern lady, fuck you, which is, well, bless your heart.
Yes, that's what she was doing. Oh, look, he's trying. You know, she kept saying, look at your facts. Guys, I want you guys at home to do your homework. Look at your facts. Kind of like treating him like a mentally challenged child, you know? And it worked. And it threw him off his game. She threw something like, it was like key words you could use with him, like temperament. You've got bad temperament, and he completely lost it. I have great temperament. So what? I lost it on Rosie O'Donnell. I'm sorry, but I have great temperament. Everybody knows he's got horrible temperament, and him doing that showed that he had really bad temperament. And she just smiled from ear to ear when he was doing that. And I could tell you the Democratic Party and a lot of Republicans and, you know, were kind of smiling themselves, just saying, oh, fuck, this guy's just burying himself. You know, it's okay.
He interrupted her 51 times.
Did he really?
Yep, 51 times. Somebody actually counted and put a video together.
Oh, wow. Well, see, that works. If he, you know, with him going against other men when he was going up, you know, trying to get the nominee, he was going, remember, he was going at it with Jeb Bush, and they had these famous battles. And he, you know, those guys aren't used to it. It's like, how do you explain it? It's like going to a stand-up, and you have a seasoned stand-up comedian, and you're trying to yell up shit at him. It's not, you're going to look stupid. They know the game. They got the mic. They have the power. She's watched so much video of him that she's broken it down, and there, I guarantee you, she's had people say, now this is what you do. Look at his habits. And she played him like a fiddle. Sorry, but she did.
I admit I didn't watch the debates because I don't like the debate format. I mean, it's too, I mean, it's too constrained. It leaves it far too easy for people to have, you know, prepared talking points and to pivot and to have, you know, canned zingers and shit like that. But when you say that Trump interrupted her 51 times, you mean he interrupted her when she had the floor? When it was her.
Oh, you can't.
I mean, that, you see, that's the thing. He's like a child.
Yeah.
That didn't never had enough timeouts.
Well, I just saw a biography about him, and yeah, he pretty much, I mean, he's had a pretty easy life. And she nailed him huge.
And he, you know, they used to say about George Bush that he was born on third base and thinks he hit a triple. But considering that Trump was handed all this money from his father's real estate dealings and then lost a substantial amount of it, Trump was born on third base and hit a double.
Yeah, so, like, he's the thing that she brought up, which was really you could tell it was, he was steaming, was where she, and I didn't know this, that he had apartments, condos or whatever, buildings that he owned, and he wasn't giving them out. If you were black, he wouldn't give them to you. And instead of him just yelling, going, "That's not true, that bullshit," that, I mean, I would have lost it, okay? She made him look like an imbecile, a complete, like a, if racism, if she made him look like a racist person, that was right there, that just killed him. That absolutely killed him. And he didn't have anything good to come back on that. He just stood there, just, you could tell he's thinking the next question instead of saying, well, I really got to get to this point about, you know, not giving the apartments to colored people. I really have to clear that up, you know. And he looked like a fucking idiot, you know. She made him look like a racist person that, you know, will not, you know, rent out his facilities to a colored person, nor will he pay. Like his answer was, she said something about, you also don't pay people. There's hundreds and hundreds of people that you've stiffed that you've not paid. And he said, well, maybe I didn't like their job. Maybe I didn't like the job they did. And it just made him look so bad. She made him look so bad, you know. It's kind of like saying, hey, Scott, remember your ex-girlfriend? She told me that you beat her up.
Right.
I mean, it just absolutely made you look like an idiot. And you, instead of saying, that's not true, you say, well, you know, it happens. Maybe she deserved
it. I'm so glad that we don't have anyone in Hangouts that behave that way.
Oh, I know. And I want to throw this out, and I want,
I'm being sarcastic, just letting you guys know.
No, we've seen sarcasm before. Don't worry.
I know, and I don't know if you're Rand Campbell's buddy. I don't want to bug you, but he did invite me to fight him. And I said, okay, if he said he had a lot of money, and he goes, I'll pay for your ticket. And I said, you pay for my ticket there and back. I'll waste 2 days to beat the fuck out of you. Like, I will. And Mykeru knows I have no qualms about that. So, Rand Campbell, if you're out there, buy me my ticket. Be a true Christian. You said you would buy me a ticket. Because I've got friends in the Dominican I've already talked to, because I want somebody to videotape it. And I've already talked to them about them. They'll videotape me kicking the fuck out of you. So buy me my ticket, and I'll be there.
I will say Rand has been on our show 3 times.
Yeah, what's that about? Like, do you argue with him? Because I saw he looks like a pug with some level of Down syndrome. He does. I'm sorry. He does. He's got a fat face.
No. When we first had him on, we didn't know what was going to happen. If you go to the very, very first Rand Campbell interview that we did, you'll hear Jerry say, get him on, get him off. We had a wonderful conversation with the guy. We never argued. He was very, very cool with us. I have no issues with Rand. Well, I shouldn't say that. There's a gal in Hangouts named Brenda, who is transgender and who's actually from Minneapolis.
What's she look like?
And I have never seen her. Oh. You may have seen her in Hangouts before. But Rand was just beating the crap out of her for really no reason, aside from the fact that she's in transition.
Right.
You know, that's funny because you know, I have a friend, Melody Dickens, who's not she's not just transgender, she's transsexual, and one of the biggest problems she's been having, people making her crazy, are what are called TERFs, which are trans exclusive radical feminists. They're radical feminists that want to tell trans people, you're not really a woman, because this, that, the other thing. You know, it's like womanhood, the sisterhood, is an exclusive club and you're not invited. And it struck me, and I said to her at the time, it's just yet another way that radical feminists and fundamentalist Christians find themselves playing on the same team.
Right. Yeah. I thought you said Turks, like the chocolate bar. It's
no,
Turks?
T-E-R-F.
Okay.
T-E-R-F, trans exclusionary radical feminists.
Isn't that amazing? Everybody's got a club now. It used to be good or bad. now it's just like everybody's got a fucking name.
I used to try to explain this in terms of ideology, and now, you know, having dealt with some of the people on free thought blogs and within the atheist movement, who, you know, atheism was going good for a while there in the mid-aughts. I mean, it was making definite inroads. The online atheist community was thriving, and then it got infested by social justice warriors and people who are just basically greed heads that were out for themselves. And
I just explain
it in terms of the internet provides a forum for some really fucking awful people.
Yes, for sure. And I remember, I'm sorry if you don't know these people, Michael, but there's a guy named Brett Keen out there. And to me, Brett Keen seems like, I don't believe that he is a Christian. I don't. I think he is an atheist that just wants people to send him money. Okay.
Most recently he had a GoFundMe type site up to buy him a car, and his goal was $10,000.
I didn't know that, but that's what I mean. I mean, that just proves my point.
I bought a new car in 94. It was a Toyota, and I paid $11,500. What is he going to get for $10,000?
Right.
But that's the point.
He's going to crack hookers, isn't he?
But it's the point, though.
It's the point of e-begging.
Yes, that's the point I don't like. I mean, that just to me just seems so... It seems... I've seen this where...
I'm trying to get to why you think he's an atheist.
He just seems like an atheist. He used to be an atheist. From my understanding, he was an atheist. And then all of a sudden, he had a conversion.
No. You got to be very careful, because...
That's what he was.
What I'm saying is there is a subtype of fundamentalist Christian whose form of witnessing and evangelizing is to claim that they used to be an atheist.
But my understanding, he was.
That claim is complete and utter horseshit.
Yeah, like, I think that some people will say that they're atheist, or they say they were atheist before, and now they're a Christian, they found God, and buy my book. You know? I see that, and I don't think he's at that level of, you know, buy my book, because I don't think he could write a book, but...
He has written a book.
He has?
Yeah.
Jesus Christ. So...
Yeah, you know, Brett Keen's deal is... He was around way back in the day when all this started, and he was fairly successful. But he became Brett Keen with the e-begging and all of that.
Successful at and what? At Christianity or atheism? What was he?
Just being a YouTuber. Okay. Just being a YouTuber.
Okay.
And
doing that Pat Robertson thing where, give me money or God is going to call me home.
Maybe, yeah. I don't know. I'm not a Brett Keen historian by any sense of the word, but... apparently he prayed out to God because he had a sick child, and my heart goes out to any sick child. And apparently God, quote unquote, healed this child. And that's where he became a theist, and then everything went, hell broke loose, and the amazing atheist went after him. And so now
if he did really have something like that happen to him, like I would. Like, the thing is, you could only take people's word for it, right? You can't sit there and say that didn't happen. I wasn't there. But that is a pretty powerful thing if that did happen, where his child was gravely ill and he had, you know, he begged God, you know, and all of a sudden, miraculously, the child is okay. I could see that being very moving, and that could change a person's mind and say, yes, there is something out there. Whatever. It could be that the child just got well on her own or whatever. We don't know, but you don't have that feeling of that grieving father. You know, you don't know.
I would check that out, because, you know, when you put it all together, he claims he was an atheist, then he had a sick child, then God cured the kid. It sounds like he's running the playbook.
Well, yeah, but you don't know, because I've done that. I've done this where I've said stuff like that, and then it's bit me in the ass, where I just said, I go, yeah, fucking guy's stupid enough, he can't even write a book. And then, you know, Scott's like, he wrote a book. So it's
I'm not saying it didn't happen, but, you know, there is a middle ground between saying the guy is full of horseshit and just believing him on, well, faith. I mean, right. there's got to be a way to verify these people's stories.
I think people know.
I have so much experience with people who are evangelizing and claim in one way or another that they used to be an atheist, that I'm just skeptical now. I want to know what kind of atheist they were, first of all, because there isn't one kind of atheist. Atheists can run the gamut from a critical atheist who doesn't believe in the existence of the theistic God because it doesn't fit in with a known worldview. And in fact, a lot of religious claims are just internally inconsistent. And then there are people that claim to have been an atheist because, you know, they think God is cramping their style or whatever. You could be as we have learned from the shit that went on in the atheist community with people involved with free thought blogs and Atheism Plus. You can call yourself an atheist and be an atheist, you know, that you don't accept the existence of the theistic God for any number of really crap reasons.
Mm-hmm. I know, but it's so hard to, like, I could easily do this. Guys, I was jumped before this interview, okay? And they robbed me. Now, Scott, whoever's out there, please, I don't even have bus money for tomorrow. I mean, I was jumped. You can't verify. It's like, unless you were here, that's the thing about the net. You could hide. You're just voices or video, and you could totally lie about, the thing is, you don't know if somebody's telling you.
It's stuffed by swindle, really.
Yeah, you don't know, and it sucks if the person really is telling you the truth. It sucks that you have to sit there and say, well, I don't know about that, pal. Like, if he did have an experience like that, that is a powerful experience. If he's making that up, then I can't, you know, it's like, fuck, it sucks that you gotta, if you make that shit up, that is really horrible. And I've seen people make up some pretty horrible things. I've seen guys, they had the guy from Ghost Hunters, the Paranormal State, who's in jail now, running a scam where people send him money, like, you know, $50 for a mug of, you know, Paranormal State. Well, I've been to Comic-Con. The most I've ever paid is $20 for a mug. You know, this guy, $50. And he's a crackhead. You know, now, can I verify he's a crackhead? No. I can only go by what is shown on the news. I don't, or, you know, internet stuff. People make videos. It could be a total, you know, the guy's problem. Maybe he's got mental problems. But, you know, the guy's just begging for money, and people keep giving this guy money. You don't know if he's really, if it's a mental thing, if it's a drug thing. You don't know.
Well, first of all, you know, you have to be careful, because, I mean, people perpetrating hoaxes for whatever ideological reason is well established. Look at all the cases of people who faked hate crimes against themselves. I mean, drawing a noose on the board outside of their dorm room, or painting, you know, gays get out on their door, and then burning their own house down.
Hey, did you see the video?
Or the woman who claimed that conservatives jumped her and put a bee carved a bee on her face. Oh. The only problem was the bee was backwards, which indicated she did it in the mirror.
Yes. Did you see the video? The guy put up a video because his ex-wife was saying that, like, she was saying he was beating her up. So he put a hidden camera in her room. She was kicking the shit out of herself, calling the cops. Mm. It was brutal.
I did see that. Yeah.
Isn't that scary, Scott?
That's very scary.
If I told you that, if I said my girlfriend is beating herself up, you'd be like, yeah, sure, V, you're not slapping her out. We know the way you talk. And I'm like, I'm serious, man. I didn't hit her. And it's like, I saw her face, dude. She's got a black eye. Like, fuck, she gave herself a black eye? Give me a break, pal.
Did it look like Edward Norton in Fight Club in the
process? Yes, it did. It really did. Not to the extent where she was ramming her face into a wall, but she was punching herself in the face.
It wasn't a cut me mix situation.
Yeah, it was disturbing, you know. But all right, so if people don't know, we're talking to the boss at Positively Godless.
I'm not the boss.
Who's the boss there? Is it Jerry?
No, we all are. Everyone has their own roles.
But that's impossible. That's 30-30-30. Who's got the 10%?
It's an anarcho-syndicalist collective.
Say again?
It's an anarcho-syndicalist collective.
Right. We're all equals. And Positively Godless is just the name of our show. And we want it to be a community where everyone can feel good about their non-belief. And they can be positive about it. Positively Godless is a very universal name. Everyone gets on my case. Especially I'm on a hangout. I'm the voice of that show, especially in hangouts where they say, well, you're not being very positive.
Or what, well,
what are you saying? We're negative atheists?
Oh, shut up.
Well, no, even like if I'm talking to Darwin's deity, for example.
Oh,
right?
Yeah. You don't know who this is, Michael. You don't. I'll send you a vid.
Yeah, we'll get into this.
I'll send you a vid of him, and you'll see, and your mind will explode. I'm not joking.
Not joking. And he'll say, you're not being very, very positive. You're trolling. Well, clearly he doesn't understand what universal titleship means, which means the same thing as the word kiss. Kiss could be very, very soft and sweet. It could be the kiss of death. Positively Godless could mean I'm positive that there is no God. I'm a positive person. You can take any number of those universal terms.
I never took that title as you were being like rubbing it in people's face. It's positively no God. I just thought you were a positive person that, you know, you don't believe, but you're not doom and gloom. Like, there's no God, man. It's over. You know, it's kind of like, you know.
I often describe myself as an evangelical atheist, spreading the good word that all this stuff that's making you nervous is all bullshit.
Like what? Like Scientologists?
What about Scientologists?
That's what they do. They believe like they got like if you got like a bad alien in you that makes you nervous, so you work on getting that out of you. It's like there's all any bad thoughts that you have, those are alien souls inside of you. I'm not making this shit up.
They're called full body thetans.
Right. So you're making me stutter for no reason. You know this shit.
Yeah, I know.
So
L. Ron Hubbard, even in Dianetics, L. Ron Hubbard thought that a lot of mental illness was
caused by
engrams that were implanted. Because the fetus was listening to stuff that was happening outside of mom's womb. And then, but then in Scientology, when you get to like the operational Aiden level 7, after which you've spent a lot of years and a shitload of money, that's when they unload the crazy Xenu shit on you.
But you know, with that, you need to get, it takes, like they've got to milk millions out of you before you get to know that Xenu is, you know, that shit. So that's got to be quite the mind fuck to go through all that. I think that happened to Leanna Rimes, where she got to that level, and I think they told her about Xenu, and she just said, get the fuck out of here. You know.
Jim Lippard wrote an article in 1995, Jim Lippard, called Scientology versus the Internet. It was about the fact that Scientology was trying to vertically spam the Usenet group alt-religion Scientology, because some ex-Scientologists were releasing exactly those documents that normally would take you years and shitloads of money to get to the crazy stuff, and, you know, to kind of do an end run around it. So, yeah.
Doesn't it amaze you that, like, you look at the big names that are in there, and to me, I've watched a couple documentaries on it. If you're a celebrity, you're set. Like, it's pretty nice, okay? If you're not, it's beyond shit.
Nice. In fact, what happens is that they have a celebrity center,
yes,
and celebrities are treated very differently than the rank and file Scientologists.
Yeah, so I would totally believe, like, it's that whole me thing. You could tell that with a Tom Cruise, that he thinks he's the second coming, where, you know, I'm so important, everyone's kissing my ass.
But, you know, it's always that way when we were talking about, you know, evangelical atheism and shit that makes you nervous. Even Christianity or most religions that have some sort of sense of salvation plan becomes a me thing. I mean, they talk about fellowship and community, but basically, you know, it's people working on their own salvation plan because they're worried what's going to happen when their all-loving, all-knowing, compassionate and understanding God hits them with a fucking hammer after they die because of something they did.
Yeah, but it's the whole thing. Like, it's like, you ever see the episode of SpongeBob where Mr. Krabs gets a heart attack, goes in the hospital, and they go, you had a heart attack, and they show him the bill, and he's like, not at these prices. You know, it's impossible. Like, the numbers, you know, you need these books. I love it where they give you a couple books for free, and then it's like, oh, if you want more, it's going to cost you $180. And then if you need, okay, once you're done that, you're going to need this, and you're going to need this, and then you're going to need, you know, you need these booklets, you need this. I always thought, if that's what bothered me about any type of religion, if it is true that there is a God or anything out there, I don't need you to tell me. I don't need Darwin's deity to tell me there is a God. You should pick up a Bible, anywhere, pick it up, and you should know. You should just sit there and go, yes, there is a God, not look at it and read it and go, wow, this is some crazy shit. You know, this is like, this God here is pretty mean. I mean, he's not all loving, as, you know, they like to yell out, what a loving guy, what a loving God. What are your thoughts, Scott?
Well, you know, there's a book by a guy, Edmund Cohen. It's called The Mind of the Bible Believer. And one of the most interesting takes from that book is that this is why in philosophy, even though it seems pedantic, before a discussion even happens, people tend to define their terms. What do you mean by this? What do you mean by that? And it's not just hair splitting. It's because to an ideologue or a fundamentalist Christian, words mean very different things. To you, truth might mean verifiable, objective reality. To them, truth is, well, their dogma.
That's what Matt Slick does. Hey, Scott? Yeah. Like, what are your thoughts on that?
You know, you asked me a couple of questions. I'll answer the first one, you know, kind of what I think about the sadistic God, right?
Mm-hmm.
And all I can think about is a quote from my friend Tracy Harris. And she says, you either have a God who sends a child, who sends child rapists to rape children, or you have a God who simply watches and says, when you're done, I'm going to punish you. If I could stop a person from raping a child, I would. That's the difference between me and your God.
Yes, I remember her saying that. That was very nice, actually.
That's a classic problem of the problem of evil. The problem of evil is, if you take Anselm's criteria for the theistic God, that he is omniscient, omnipotent, omnibenevolent, and a couple of other things, that if evil happens, it's either because God doesn't stop it, in which case he's not omnibenevolent, or he can't stop it, in which case he's not omnipotent, or he doesn't know about it, in which case he's not omniscient.
Right. Hogtie told me that once. That was really cool. He did say that to me. And I believe he got that because I was looking all over, and Christopher Hitchens pretty much says the same thing.
The theistic answer to that is to say, well, free will, which is a fucking non sequitur.
Yeah, the free will. What are your thoughts on that, Scott? Sorry, you didn't get to answer the second question. I'm sorry. I know we're jumping all over the place. I'm sorry. You got to get in, Scott.
No.
Think of this as Lord of the Flies. Just get in, man.
It's like get that conch.
Check up into the boards.
And I've admitted this publicly and privately that I'm an idiot. You know, I'm benevolent. I can barely even say that word. I think the joke is, if you give me more than three syllables, I have no idea what you're talking about.
That's my bit. Stop it.
No, that's my bit.
No, all right. We could share it. As long as we're not playing the same city. If we're playing the same city or doing the same hangout, you tell me if you're going to say it. Because I don't want to look like a fucking idiot. And then say it 5 minutes later and they go, Scott Lawrence said that already. And I'd be like, God damn it. This is bullshit.
Son of a bitch.
We had a deal.
We had a form contract signed by two attorneys. You know, it's so funny that everyone thinks they're going to convince the other one because they used a big word or they used a mishmash of things. You know, Matt Slick again does the same type of tactic as you mentioned, where he'll always, every single call he's on, he'll say, is it always wrong to kill babies merely for one's personal pleasure?
Pleasure, yeah.
Well, okay, that's entrapment. You know, you're just now playing a game. Darwin's deity, who, Mike, right?
Mm-hmm. Michael.
Okay. Yeah, you're gonna freak out. You're going to start hitting things. You'll start throwing things against the wall once you hear this guy.
Oh, he'll lose his mind.
You're going to lose your freaking mind of just sheer anger of... When we were talking about maybe a half hour ago, everything is scripted. And I come into Hangouts. My goal is to throw people off their script and just have a conversation. And then all of a sudden, I'm a troll.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, it's not just that these people are scripted, which is bad enough, but they're smug about it.
Oh, he's beyond smug. He's beyond. I don't ever want you to talk to him, Mykeru. I don't want you to talk to him because you will get angry. And it's no point.
I've lost it with him before, and I read him the Riot Act.
Yeah,
and
I don't
it's somewhere online.
But you did a good job. I mean, he'll do stupid shit where, if you get him and you do get him on stuff, he'll just sit there and go, you know, Scott, you're being a troll. I don't talk to you anymore. You're being a troll, right. And I just find that just such bullshit.
Well, that's just irritating, and you know that's just an internet thing where if you say something, you know, a troll is anyone who disagrees with you after a point. I mean, the term troll, first of all, the term troll was never supposed to refer to the thing that lives under a bridge. I don't know where the fuck they got that. It's a fishing term.
Is it?
From trolling.
Oh yes, trolling. Yeah.
You throw out a bunch of hooks behind the boat and see what bites.
You know what that thing under the bridge is. You know what they call that thing underneath that bridge?
What?
My fucking career.
Yeah. So most people that use the term troll don't even know what it's derived from, what it's referring to. And then it just became this kind of crap thing, you know, like calling someone a misogynist or something.
Oh, but you got us, Michael. You got to see the way he does this. I mean, if you engage,
you know,
Scott,
I
you know
actually,
what it's like. You engage
right,
him.
Right. And Michael, what he'll call you is one of his stalkers. If you talk to him more than once or twice, you are now one of his stalkers.
Yeah, the man's, you would think of a principal that took his job way too serious, like a vice principal.
Is this a guy or a teenage girl?
No, it's kind
it's
of,
a guy.
It's weird. It's just... He talks very, if you talk to him, what's his tone of voice? It's very condescending.
Vito, I think you could do a good impression of it if you monotone the crap out of your voice.
Mykeru, how do you know that there is no God? Excuse me, I'm speaking. How do you not know that there is no God?
I don't have to.
I've not done. I'm not done.
That was frightening.
That's exactly how he speaks. I'm not joking. That's what he does. Okay? That's his game. You will lose your mind if you're talking to him, okay?
No, I'll just talk over him and say I'm not the one making.
He'll mute you. He mutes
then
you.
He'll mute you.
He's in control of the room. He's in control of the room.
That's not his fault though. That's your fault.
No, yes, it is my fault. Totally, I agree with you there.
You have a discussion with someone who controls the venue.
Yes.
Then you're a fucking idiot.
Well, that's why I told MK who runs the room. I told MK. I said I'm not doing your room anymore. And he's like, please, you got to come back. He keeps sending me invites. And I'm like, I'm not interested. It's very unfair.
I'll put it to you this way. This is this is how bad this guy is. We've talked about Matt Slick. We've talked about Gino. We talked about Rand Campbell. None of them that we just that I just mentioned have a soundboard specifically made from the quotes that they've used.
I'll put a link
this
to it.
This guy does.
Yeah, he has a soundboard.
Soundboard.
Yeah.
Somebody made.
Yeah, yeah. No joke. And it is, I thought it was a lie. I talked to Ocean last night. He sent me the link to it, and I played with it for, no joke, a good half hour, just giggling to myself like an idiot. It is absolutely hilarious. You ever see when he loses it? For fuck's sakes, MK. Like, it's it's scary.
And I use it. I use it in a hangout when I was in there with him, and he lost his mind.
Yes, he did. Yes,
and
he did.
I think he says, like, you're interrupting. Like, you don't need to say that. I have it right here. He got so mad. It was funny.
No, you didn't.
You know, but there's an important point there about, you know, this guy muting it and what Vito learned from his experience being on a stream with these people, which is you never, ever engage these people on any playing field that isn't completely level.
Yeah, I know. But it's, you know what it is?
And I've done that. I've done that a lot.
I'll tell you what it is. I'll tell you what it is.
Arguing with morons.
No, I thought if I were to do a show, I never mute anybody. Never. I don't care if you're wrong, right, we're arguing. I won't mute you, okay? I thought they said they're Christian. I thought you're Christian. You understand respect. There's no respect. Scott, there's no respect.
Idea?
I thought there would be respect.
None.
I thought there would be respect. I'm sorry. And Scott, I've seen you do shows, and I've seen it get pretty heated, and you've always shown nothing but respect, even if the person is totally wrong, okay? You've been very respectful. You've stopped it. You've said, okay, this is what we're going to do. I mean, I remember when Matt Slick actually hung up, and you worked your ass off to get the debate together. He hung up.
I had to call him on a cell phone and, like, you need to come back.
Yes.
You agreed to do that.
Yes. I remember your face, and I felt it. Like, my stomach dropped. You were like, he just left. He just left.
Yeah.
And I just thought, oh, fuck. And I know how much work you put into that. And I just thought, please get him back, because that's just stupid. And you got him back, but you were fair. You never, no one could sit there and say, hey, you were biased or whatever. You were like a referee. And I think when you do these things, you have to be a referee. Because if you take sides, even if the person is wrong or you don't like the person, at the end of the day, people are going to walk away going, that wasn't 50-50. I'm sorry, that wasn't.
Yeah, what I liked what we did with that is that each Tyler, Jerry, and I had our own topics. We didn't discuss our own topics prior to going on live. We didn't discuss any topics with J.D. Kane or Matt Slick. Everyone was blind.
Right.
And that worked.
Yes, it does.
You know, that got us, you know, it got us to what we're at 6,600 views for that episode. I'm like, holy crap. I mean,
no, it was great. I still watch it to this day because I really enjoy. I'm gonna have Alex Malpe in a couple of weeks. He's in Italy right now, and Alex Malpe stumped him on the show, which I wanted to ask him about. Remember what's his name? Alex, Scott, you know who I'm talking about. He's been on
Alex Botton.
No, not Alex Botton. Alex, his last name Malpe. I'll put it up. I'll put his proper name down. I'm doing it absolutely a disservice, and hopefully he doesn't hear this. But he went on that show on the Bible Wingnut show.
The
Bible Thumping Wingnut show, and did an awesome job. Because usually what these guys will do is they'll kind of pick on you. Like, it'll be three of us, Michael, against, just say Scott came on. Well, it's me, you, and some other guy. And if any question gets too hard, you know to come in and save my ass, you know, where you will come in and go, excuse me, Scott, you're being rude. Scott, I don't think you understand what's going on here. And you're confused. I mean, Scott would be confused sitting there saying, what did I do wrong? We're having a discussion, you know, and it's really bad. And that's something that I just think that, as you know, if you want a good show, and I try to explain that to MK, you want people to kind of respect you, pal. You want people to come on and say, I'm going to get a fair shake. You know, I'm not going to be treated like a fucking, you know, garbage. I'm going to be treated with respect. Even if you don't deserve respect, if you're a guest, treat people with respect. Just don't bring them on next time. You just sit there and say, you know, that's the last time I'm going to have that person on. You don't sit there and have some person on and just make a fucking a roast out of the whole situation. You get nowhere. Because I love the conversations.
I will hand it to MK recently. He has been kicking Darwin's Didi or Darth Dawkins or whatever name. And that joke, and that's his new name.
I know. He's I was there when Darth he – that night it was World War III. It was me, Ocean. Veckel was in there, and I yelled out I told Rand Campbell I was going to beat the fuck out of him. And
can you send me the link for that? Because I've been dying to see that. I've been hearing all about it from Gus.
And Gus was probably watching because Rand Campbell wanted to fight me and we were going at it. And I called everybody in the room, I think a bunch of fucking idiots. And I didn't mean that towards Veckel or Ocean. And there was another guy there. And I didn't mean everybody in the room, but I was so angry, Scott. I was like, everybody in this room are fucking idiots, you know, and it just you just lose it. They make you lose it.
Yeah, well, you know, they're probably fucking idiots, too, because they're tacitly going along.
Well, I like Ocean. Ocean's good. And Veckel, I mean, he is a Christian, but he is a nice guy. And I don't want people to just think I always end up arguing and fighting with people. And I hate that. I hate it. I mean, I've never done it with science. I've never done it with. I've interviewed everybody, but it just seems whenever you talk to a Christian, that is at a next level, they're nuts.
Don't become enamored with the term Christian as though there's something that goes along with this, as though it represents a moral worldview, because it doesn't. And you got to recognize that some people, whether they're atheism plus or Scientologists or Christians or whatever, some people just adhere to an ideology because it gives them an outlet for cruelty.
Yes, but Michael, this is the thing that throws me off. I have tons of Christian people all over me. My city is very Christian. I'm atheist. They know that. They are very sweet, very kind. They still invite me to church every Sunday. They think I'm funny. They love my company, and they're very incredibly sweet people. So when I think Christian, I think very loving, kind. Then you go on these hangouts, and it's like Antichrist Christians, you know?
Yeah.
Like complete nutters. Like they're just...
It's like I was saying, atheists, I mean, they're not all Christians are the same. First of all, I mean, what Christians are you talking about? Catholics? Protestants?
No, they don't like Catholics. I asked about that.
101... factious denominations of Christianity? I mean, what are we talking about?
I don't know what kind of Christians... What would you say Darwin is, besides an idiot? What would you say Darwin's deity... What would you say he is, Scott? Like, what kind of Christian?
You know, if I were to answer for him, I'm a follower of the teachings of Jesus Christ, is probably what he would say.
Right, yeah, so I don't
know. Would be another question that he would avoid.
Yes, he never answers a question, that guy. Same with him and, Bell sometimes answers if he's in a good mood. I don't know.
What I always like to ask people that say they're followers of Jesus Christ is I like to quote that. First of all, we don't know what Jesus said because all of this shit was written 40 to 120 years after his death. But if we're going to take the quotes at face value, when Jesus said, there are those among you who will not taste of death until the kingdom of God comes, meaning that Jesus was going to come back within the lifetime of people there. It's like, what do you think about that?
Yeah, but here's the thing.
Jesus
that's even
late.
Yes.
Do you think he's stuck in traffic? Could he not find his keys? That happens to me. I can't find my keys. I can't leave
Michael,
the house.
Do you know what this guy, Matt Slick, do you know what a Calvinist is?
Yeah.
Okay, so that's what he is. And I didn't know that unless my understanding is in the way it was explained to me.
So he thinks that God rewards you materially for your faith.
No, God has to. The way Hogtied explained this to this is a man named Hogtied, very nice guy. He explained it like this. He said, unless God directly somehow talks to you, that's the only way you're going to get in heaven. Something like that. It was like that. And if he doesn't talk to you or you're not chosen by God, you're not allowed in the kingdom of heaven. So
you know,
shit.
Whenever I hear someone talking about God talking to him, I always think about that old Sam Kinison routine.
Oh, God,
I think he was talking about Pat Robertson. Where
the 900-foot Jesus?
No. He's sorry. Pat Robertson. God is fucking with Pat Robertson. He was like, watch this. Pat.
Yeah, I love
Pat,
that.
This is God. Go out and check your tire pressure. Now watch. He's going to go do it.
Right.
I love Sam Kinison. This girl asked me, the girl that was, I remember that chick I was telling you about the nude pics? I'll send you the pics. She asked me who my favorite comic was, and it was always Sam Kinison. When I saw Sam Kinison the first time, I literally laughed so hard I was crying. Very, very funny man, and it fucking sucks that he died.
You know, you want a bummer story? Here's an even bigger bummer story. 91, my girlfriend bought me tickets to go see Sam Kinison. He was going to perform at the Riverside Casino in Laughlin, Nevada. We got there in line, we were waiting, and someone came forward and said, the show is delayed. You know why? Because that's when he met that pickup truck.
Oh, no. Do you have the tickets?
No, I don't have the tickets.
Oh, fuck. I wish you kept those fucking tickets. That would have been quite the moment. I would have bought them off you. I would have paid a mint for those tickets. I would have paid a mint. Okay?
I think she did them by phone, so we had to pick them up.
I wish you kept those tickets. It's awful. I remember that day that happened. The girl that I was going out with, she felt really bad for me, so she fucked me twice and gave me a blowjob like 3 times. So it was really cool. But it kind of bugs me when I think about he died, because it was a really cool day. I got laid all kinds, but I was so sad.
I'm sure Sam would have thought that was.
And that's what I was thinking. I was going, like, I felt dirty. Like, she's like, aren't you going to come? And I was like, I just couldn't because I felt dirty. But then I thought, if Sam
Scott,
was...
Scott, do you need this level of detail? Because I don't.
Sorry, Scott. Scott knows I'm kind of fucked in the head. So he kind of knows that this is the type of, you know, when he agreed to do the show, he's like, do I have to wear a condom? And I was like, you better.
I have 3 on right now.
Yeah, it's the triple, the trifecta.
Do you turn them inside out because fuck her pleasure?
Right.
Exactly. Right. So
one of my favorite comedians is Sebastian Maniscalco. If you're familiar with him.
Sebastian Maniscalco. I think so. What bit does he? Yeah. Do you know a quick bit?
He's the comedian to accountants.
No. Right. You know, he's all about what's wrong with people. Just points out you know, things that he observes in the world, you know, how people just don't care what they look like when they go to the grocery store, that they're just comfortable. I'm not one to try to, repeat.
Right. It sucks when they're like, hey, do his bit. And it's like, you kind of don't do it. You don't do it a service. You know, it's kind of like, oh, you walk away fucking up the bit. And everybody's like, yeah, I'm sure he was hilarious. It's like, no, you don't understand. Right. It's like a white guy. It's like a white guy trying to do an old Bill Cosby, you know.
Right.
And it's like, just shut up and don't do it. You're fucking up the bit, you know. Just
what's
just,
even
I'll
worse
look
is a white guy doing Eddie Murphy.
Yes, remember everybody. But when we were kids, we would all do the Goonie Goo Goo. We'd giggle.
Ice cream.
Yeah, the ice cream.
Yeah,
ice cream. Ice cream. You can't afford it. You can't afford. Oh, it was awful. But it was. Yeah. I love Eddie Murphy. Were you always? Like, how were you brought up as, like, were you Christian? Were you, like, when did you question the whole thing for you? Or were you always an atheist? There are some people that were always atheist.
Well, you know, I was baptized Catholic.
Oh,
and
me too.
It was, you know, it was church on Sundays, every
right
Sunday.
Off.
And, you know, it was just, you know, you just knew what you're getting into. Like, how's everybody doing? And it's like, oh, what the hell is this? And then, you know, you get involved in your church youth group in high school because you want to belong. And I don't know. I just never thought about it. And I don't know when it happened where I kind of got sort of questioning things. Maybe it's, you know, this your station in life or whatever the case may be. Like, is there a God out there?
Yeah, yeah.
And I think it was Matt Dillon, honey, Dick. Sorry.
Cocklicker.
Yeah. He did. Matt Dillon does not like us, by the way. So
why?
That's
why doesn't he not like you?
Because Matt Dillahunty is a dick.
Well, Matt Dillahunty. Oh, what a sorry. Funny. I know you've heard that before. See, I try to screw up a joke. But, you know, and it was partly our fault. You know, at least I'll personally take responsibility for it. You know, when we first started out with Positively Godless over a year and a half ago now, it was like, let's get the biggest guests on, and I'm going to reach out to Matt Dillahunty, Ray Comfort. We're going to go bigger than home.
Yeah.
And
There's nothing wrong with that.
Yeah. And it was right around that time where G-Man was on his... You know the Dillahunty thing, and I asked Dillahunty, would you ever have a conversation with G-Man? And Dillahunty replied by email, I wouldn't have a conversation with him even by proxy. And I read that on air to G-Man, and Dillahunty freaked. He's like, I will never do your show. I don't like what you do.
That's not cool. That's bullshit.
What's the problem there?
Yeah, what's the problem?
He didn't say it was off the record. And frankly, a lot of people don't understand this. You send me email. Guess what? It's mine.
God, right. did you ever see what I did? Issue. Did you ever see what I did to Matthew Baxter, for fuck's sakes, his emails? I'll read them online. I don't give a shit. I don't give a fuck. If he did that, I would have thought it was kind of cool that you would do that. I wouldn't have been offended at all. You didn't say anything bad there. I mean, that, I don't know.
Well,
to me, it's just...
Dillahunty's issue was because he said the word by proxy, which is mean between us, I guess, in his...
Oh, I didn't even know what that word meant. That's what that means?
I apparently so. Again, I think it's more than three syllables, so I don't know.
Yeah, I wouldn't know that.
Honestly, fuck people who do that, because, you know... I don't work. If someone did that to me, I'd say, I don't work for you. I didn't sign a non-disclosure.
Right.
So what is your problem?
Yeah, I've
sent us some nasty emails.
Oh, man. See, that really sucks, because I thought he would be a little cooler than that. You know, I really do, because I...
Well, what would possibly make you think Matt Dillahunty would be cool at all?
Well, I do enjoy his debates. He beat shit out of Saiten Bruton.
Oh, God. You know, Matt Dillahunty, if you read a half dozen, atheist books like Joseph DeLeydon's The Last Superstition or George H. Smith's Atheism, The Case Against God, and memorized a couple of the counterarguments to the standard theistic arguments for the existence of God, you could do exactly what Matt Dillahunty does.
Right. Well, yeah.
And the real proof of what kind of rational person he is that Matt Dillahunty is able to give the appearance of being a rational human being when he is giving stock responses to stock theistic arguments. But then you get him off on something else, atheism plus something, and he shows himself that he's absolutely incapable of rational and critical thinking.
Right.
Yeah. And that really sucks, because to me,
the Dunning-Kruger level of the great disparity between his ego and his actual level of competence.
Yeah, to me, ego is everything, and I love meeting people or talking to people. I go to Comic Cons all the time, and it's funny. My mom's hilarious. Like, if I got a picture with a famous person, she's like, "Did you talk to them?" And it's like, yeah, Mom, we had dinner. We hung out.
I wonder if he lays awake at night and sometimes thinks to himself, you know, I hope no one notices that I'm nothing but a bag of hot air.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was like remember Julius Caesar, whenever he'd walk into a room, he'd have
if you want to join the Matt Dillahunty fan club.
Well, I like Matt Dillahunty. Like, I like what he says, but I don't like when I hear stuff like that. It's hard. It's hard to, because I sympathize with Scott, because I try and get guests too. And the only way, like, I will do any, like, I will, people are like, how do you get big names? Well, I ask, right? I ask them. Yeah. They're like, how did you get that person? Well, I emailed them, or I asked them. I mean, Gat's sad. He's like, you know, right on the Twitter, he's like, you should not use Twitter to ask me to be on the show, you know? And I'm like, okay. So I went on his Facebook thing and I asked him on that. He never replied to me, the cocklicker. So it's like, I replied to him Twitter by saying, how else am I supposed to talk to you? Like, Like, I can't, I'm not going to your house, like, fat ass there. I'm not going to just show up if you get me a ticket. If I can't do that without, if you have an email, I'll ask you. If you're, you know, all it is just a talk. I'm, you know, I get some, I think, pretty decent guests. But it's like, if you don't ask, you don't get nobody, you know. And if they're going to be.
Go get it.
Yeah. If you don't, like with Scott, he was in a position of, hey, you know, I like your stuff. I'd like to have you on there. It'd be really nice. And it, you know, it's like he got shot in the face. And it's like, it's a heart. It sucks because when that's happened to me, where people have shot back saying some pretty fucking horrid things. And it's confusing because you're like, what do you want? Just say yes or no.
Comes down to is a matter of priorities with some people. Like in the case of Matt Dillahunty, being asked to be on the show gave Matt Dillahunty an opportunity to express his priorities, which is being a dick.
He thinks that he may be the messiah of atheism in a sense. He's got that ego.
Yeah, I could see that, but it's you know,
you
like
changed
I
the world with that fuchsia goatee.
I'm a huge fan. I am a huge fan, and I love him, Arn Raw. I don't care what anybody says. I love him. He's done the show several times. Fantastic man, wonderful. I know he's friends with Matt, and I love him. Okay, I'm sorry, I do. I'm a big fan of Seth Andrews. Okay.
Oh, God, he's like a dream guest for me. I mean, talk about a man boner. I mean,
yeah, he's
completely.
Got that. He's got that velvet voice. That
yeah.
He's wonderful, sweet guy. He is the Barry White of atheism, you know.
Absolutely, yeah.
So you get people like that, and if Matt wants to be, you know, whatever. I always go to Ozzy. Ozzy is a wonderful genius of a man that I adore. He will spend his time. He knows I'm kind of mentally challenged, so he will spend his time to make sure you understand. And I love watching him talk or having discussions. You learn. But to ask if he said, I have no interest in doing your piece of shit show, that would hurt. You know, like it would be like, ah, come on, man. I'm a fan. Like that kind of sucks. But if Matt Dillahunty wants to be like that, then whatever. Scott, you know, you can't win them all.
I'm buttered over it.
That's
life. Have you ever had a transsexual porn star just blow you off?
I have, yes. But I don't care. But I have a lot of transsexual porn stars. And what bothers me is I have Christians on here where they will, a couple of my, I told you, a couple of my YouTubes were shut down, videos, because I was having discussions with transsexual women, and there was this stalker that they told me about that hates these, that really can't stand tranny people, and thought what I was doing was a big sin, and I just thought, this guy's crazy. And he had I got a strike on my YouTube channel.
You know that being a transsexual stalker literally makes you a tranny chaser?
Yeah, that's what I told him. I said you like the dick, so fuck off, okay? So, anyways, I went to YouTube. You know, you got to do that thing where you send them if something's wrong, they could look it up. And I just said, what is wrong with this? And within 3 days, they put it up because you could tell they never checked the video. But there was nothing wrong with the video.
Well, I know about that.
Yeah. Oh, you know all about that. It really is horrendous. Where if I don't like something that Scott did, I could flag one of his videos, have it taken down. He will get it.
And they've just made it a whole lot easier.
Yes, they did. And it's bullshit. It's disgusting and bullshit, you know. And for me, what about free speech? That's why shows like Positively Godless are important. You could have these conversations. If you do not like the conversation, fucking change a channel. There's a million and one other shows to watch. But just because you don't agree with what is going on a show, you don't like a guest, if you've got some bad boner or some bad taste in your mouth, fucking go do something else. Don't ruin somebody else's day
just because
you don't like the person.
See, but that doesn't occur to people like that, because people like that are inherently Newart in his blog called eliminationists. They don't disagree with people. They don't dislike people. They don't want them to exist.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's what this guy, I felt with this
David Newart,
that's tranny kind of guy that hated trannies, this Christian guy. He was weird, Michael. He was just really, and the trannies that got back to me said, I'm so sorry. This guy has just been stalking us too. And I brought him here and I apologize. I said, no, it's not your fault. There's nothing, that I did. It's just, they just didn't like the discussion. This person did not like the discussion that we're having. And all it was just like, how was your day? What did you, it's the same shit that we're doing now. And your ideology or what do you believe in? And they didn't like that. You know, they, for some reason, trannies weren't allowed to be people. You know, it wasn't allowed to have a good day.
Literally.
I mean,
in the mindset of people like that, they're not supposed to exist.
Yeah, they just, Scott, you ever get that where you run into somebody that just hates somebody just for hate?
And they mask it. That's a problem.
Yes.
You know, Christianity is a pretty good mask.
Yeah, and the reason that we started what we did is because we were in an email forum with a Christian radio host here in Minneapolis, and he was saying some pretty harsh things about complaining about gay rights, and he would always say, the gay rights thing, like it was a bad thing that they had the right, the same right that you do, and he kind of inspired us to do this show.
That's good.
So yeah, I get it.
That's a really weird mindset because, again, I was talking to Melody Dickens about all of these things and talking about the American view of rights as the spirit of which is in the Declaration of Independence, that you are entitled to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. It's really unusual in the Declaration of Independence that they singled that out, the pursuit of happiness. And then in the Constitution, all of these rights are codified. But the idea is that the reason why they're in the Bill of Rights is because governments can't give these rights and they can't take them away because they are considered to be inalienable, that they are built into your very existence as a human being. So when someone like that says that it's wrong that these people have the same rights as you do, you know what I think? I mean, even though the word is thrown around haphazardly, I think that's just fucking un-American.
Oh, it's unnatural, not un-American. It's just unnatural to do that in any country, I think, is unnatural.
And this is the same guy, and this is the same radio host who has recently said on air that liberals are the most intolerant people around, which I find that baffling.
And that is cool, though, that you turned it around and said, fuck that, I'm going to do my own show. And that is cool,
yeah,
man.
Right. I come on Hangouts and I have some fun. You know, sure, I did the Catch a Predator thing, which was creepy. And I have fun with Doug.
Oh, yeah, what's that? What's that?
Were you on the show? Did Hanson say have a seat to you? What was your involvement?
What
there?
Is that? Catch a Predator. What's that?
Jesus. Sorry, my roll top desk just decided to move on its own. I'm a musician. I have a lot of gear.
Right.
I have a vocal harmonizer, and one of the features in the harmonizer is a like a Barry White tone. Or a male to female. I'm like, well, gosh, who would be dumb enough to fall for if I'm a female? And there's this guy named Luke Dog. Have you all heard of Luke Dog?
No, I haven't.
No, Vito, you haven't? Okay.
No, I've never heard of
him. So put your voice in like the key of C at about, 200.
A couple octaves.
Yeah.
Right. And he is very, very well known to talk to females and dying to go off air. So I'm like, gosh, he'd be dumb enough to fall for it. So I went to a public hangout as this girl named Stephanie, who's 15.
Oh, my God. Are you serious? I didn't fucking know this. This is awesome. I should have asked you this an hour ago, for fuck's sakes. What the hell have we been talking about?
I'll send you the video link too. It's great.
Yes, I want it because I'll attach it to this video.
Yeah, I'll find it when we get off here. This is a fantastic story.
I'm getting creeps already.
No, just wait for it. It's wonderful. So I'm talking to him for a couple days. I go into Hangouts like at 5:30 when I get home from work, if he's got a live Hangout. But he's constantly sending me messages like, hey, girl, how you doing? And all that stuff.
He thought you were a girl?
Yeah, because I'm a 15-year-old girl. And he's like, we need to do off air and all this stuff. And we're in a Hangout, and he's messaging me privately. He's like, and I have to paraphrase because my computer's not with me, but I have all the chat logs where he said, I want to show you something. What do you want to show me? What do you think? You know, the typical guy, creepy guy thing.
Right.
He's like, do you want to see? I'm like, and I just wrote, okay, .. Being confused, and boom, there's a dick pic.
Right.
To who he thought was a 15-year-old girl.
Oh, man.
So my friend Rose Patton, who I can call a friend even though she's batshit crazy when it comes to Flat Earth, but I still call her a friend.
Right.
She was in a Hangout where we busted the guy, and that's a video I'll send to you. Oh. Come to find out that this individual is a Tier 3 sex offender, which is the highest degree of sex offenders you can get in the state of Michigan.
Holy shit. That is great. So, that is great. Yeah. You busted him. That is
he's not a fast learner, is he?
But you know what's cool?
He's a freaking idiot.
But you know what's cool?
Go ahead,
you know what's so cool? Fucking cops would be watching this going, that fucking Scott took our bit.
Yeah.
Like, he's like, we've been trying to get this guy for years, and you got him by just screwing around pretty much.
Well, he's not arrested. He's still out there.
Oh, he didn't get arrested for that?
No, because then I have to do with this whole court thing. I don't know what to do with it, but he was convicted back in 2003 for, I think it was attempted penetration on a female.
Christ.
It did not say the age. I'm not going to give his first and last name because it's your show. I'm not going to do that. But I know his first and last name.
You weren't the only one he was working at the time.
No, he was convicted back in 2003 and in 2012, I believe. So there's multiple mugshots of this guy.
And did you know that he was like this, or did you kind of
idea.
Oh,
no,
man.
I just thought he was just a stupid dude. I just like, he's stupid enough to fall for this.
What made you make that move? Was he kind of giving out vibes that he was operating that way?
No, I was just doing it for a goof because I was going into Hangouts as a...
So it's a complete shot in the dark and you just happened to like hit a bullseye and,
Well, who's stupid enough to fall for it and how far will it go? I'm curious.
You randomly threw a dart and hit a sexual predator.
Yeah, well, I've talked to him before I even did this, and I just knew he was an idiot. And I've seen him try to work the angle with just vulnerable girls when Blab was around.
Oh, man.
And I'm like, I should just try this and see if he'd fall for it.
He was kind of giving off a vibe of it at least being...
Oh, gosh, yeah.
What a sick fucking...
I'm not saying you knew automatically that he was cruising the streets at night in the free candy van, but he was giving off...
Yeah, but you know what's cool, though? You called him out. You found him to be... Like, that is incredibly embarrassing and just shows you how much of a creep you are. That is out there. You will
Which
get...
Which even worse is he's married.
Oh, good. Send it to
That's
his
even
wife.
Worse.
Send it to his wife.
Right. Somebody already did.
Good, good. He fucking... Yeah. He's a complete nutter... disgusting pig, because if he's not doing that to you, he's also doing it to others. Okay,
well, that's what I mean. Absolutely. You weren't the only one who was working. I mean, people, you know, it's like you know, a guy in a bar that'll walk up to women and say, hi, wanna fuck, and you know, he gets drinks thrown at him, but he's just working the averages.
Yeah, that's eventually, my bit, right? That's my bit.
That's my bit. Guy like that, he's not putting all his chips on one 15-year-old. He's
right.
He's working the numbers.
But it just shows you how stupid. Like, this guy, remember when I used to do the ghost show? This idiot camera guy that's a piece of shit. His name's Alan. He's a fucking loser. And when I see him, too, I'm going to smash his face. But he goes, guess what I'm doing? And he explained to everybody that online he was posing as a girl named Bijou, and he was talking to big LA producers. And I'm like, are you fucked in the head? You know, like, are you completely, what do you think, once they find out what you're doing, don't you think this producer is going to never speak to you again? Like, what are you trying to do, blackmail them? Like, I'm not saying you were blackmailing them, Scott, but to get...
I went to a public hangout.
Yeah, you went into a public hangout. But this guy's doing it as business, trying to get in there as this girl to sell his piece of shit movies. Like, it's just, you know, like, check out these movies that my buddy Alan made. Look at these. And he's trying to pose himself as a girl. And I'm thinking, holy fuck, are you a loser? And he was a loser. But it just shows you don't know if you're online. You don't know if you're talking to, you could be talking to a girl, could be a 50-year-old woman that tells you she's 14. It could be an 800-pound man telling you that he's a girl or whatever. You don't know.
Well, you know what? A lot of people don't know that I actually use a voice modulator. And I am a 15-year-old girl.
Yeah, me too. I'm
hot.
Hi, girl.
My real name's Vicky. Vicky Kernoodle.
Vicky. Yeah, I'll definitely send you over that link.
See that. But that is great. And I wish the police would do more of that. I know they're doing that. And you were doing this. This sounds like you were doing this a while ago. The police should catch on and do this. Because I think they have a girl that pretends to do this stuff. And then they'll capture the person. When you said to capture a predator, I thought you were... Because I saw you do something a while
ago. Like a guest on their show?
No, it was on TMZ. Were you not on TMZ?
Yeah, I did TMZ in April.
Yeah, what did you do? I thought that was part of TMZ, and I thought it was kind of... When I heard you...
No... The TMZ thing was they were reporting after Prince had to do the emergency landing in Moline, Illinois.
Right.
He had a party that Saturday night where I took my then 12-year-old son, he's now 13, to a party at Paisley Park, his first party, see what his dad has been doing forever.
Right.
And I just kind of reported on how Prince looked. He looked fine. He looked, you know, relatively healthy, just maybe a little tired.
Right.
And then my kid talked to him, said, you know, I'm glad you're feeling better. 4 or 5 days later, he dies.
Yes.
It doesn't take a whole lot of fentanyl to do that to you.
Right. And what they found, evidently, and they're still, I think, looking into it, is that the pills were mislabeled.
Oh, no.
So there was fentanyl that was in pills that were not fentanyl pills.
Labeled as like benzodiazepine or something like that. Because I thought initially the little cry, he was, well, what was he taking? It wasn't benzos like Michael Jackson. He was actually taking opiates, wasn't he?
It was opiates, very, very secretly from what we know. And
this was a result of, because, you know, I've known veterans, guys that got injured in the Iraq war, who just became addicts because, you know, they gave them opiates and this stuff is really addictive. And didn't at one point Prince have an injury that they prescribed this for? And then, you know, the next thing you know, if you're predisposed to that, you're off to the races.
Yeah, he had a hip injury a few years back, and that may have done him in. But he was very, very secretive as far as what he was doing. I mean, this was not an intentional overdose. This was an accidental overdose. And he was not a drug addict, per se.
Would it be
he
the
was
same,
taking things for...
Yeah, would it be the same kind of thing as Heath Ledger? Like, he didn't know that he was taking such a heavy dose?
I don't know enough about Heath Ledger's death to comment, so...
As someone who formerly had issues because it was prescribed to me with benzodiazepines, you know, there are some drugs that are even more insidious than that. But as a frame of reference, you know, someone like Elizabeth Taylor or not Liza Minnelli, Judy Garland, Judy Garland, they would give her, you know, Seconal to go to sleep and then amphetamines to get up in the morning. Elizabeth Taylor used to line up her pills for the evening. That way it was actually sensible, because that way she could keep track of how many she took. Because some of these drugs, like opiates, you'll forget you took one, and then you take another. Right. And that second one will make you forget the first two.
Right.
And then the next thing you know, you're dead.
Yeah. Yeah. I remember I was never a big fan, and this is going to sound weird, I was never a big fan of Prince. And then when he passed, I just cried. It was weird. And I spent the day just listening to his songs, and my wife just kept saying, you're going crazy. And it's just like, I go, look how beautiful. I mean, he wrote such cool songs, and it just hit me all of a sudden. He's gone, you know? And I really did like him inside. I was kind of like, when Prince was out, I was I loved Judas Priest and all that. And I didn't want to show that I actually like Prince tunes. But it's funny, because even my stoner metal buddies years later were like, secretly, I love Prince. I was like, yeah,
A lot of people did.
Yeah, and it's just like, he was such a talented man, and what a fucking shame. What a shame. And even Michael Jackson, same thing.
Yeah, well, when I was growing up in the 80s, I mean, to a large extent, Prince was the background music of the entire 80s.
Yeah.
Prince at one time, he's written so many. Remember he wrote the famous Sinead O'Connor tune?
Nothing Compares to You.
Yes, he wrote that. He's written so many.
Monday.
Yes.
Great song.
Yes. I mean, incredibly talented man. And just a fucking, and people don't know that he was considered one of the greatest guitarists on the planet.
He was phenomenal,
and even the pop stuff that he did, that there's certain songs that you listen to so much.
I would die for you.
There was that, remember that Steven Tyler song that they used in the film Armageddon?
I know.
Crazy.
Yeah. I forget the title of it, but everyone knows that song. And Steven Tyler even said at the time, because it was such a big hit, he says, you like it now, but it's going to get he said something to the effect, but it's going to get old fast. And, even some of the Prince stuff, like Party Like It's 1999.
I only got that when it was 1999.
Yeah, but the insidious thing was, even when you were fucking tired of that song, you didn't want to hear it anymore, it would still make you like kind of jitter in your
seat.
Yes,
it would. Yeah.
Damn you, Prince. Damn you.
Yeah.
It's kind of like when you hear Don't Stop Believing, that piano whine come on, like, there it is.
Everybody in the car just kind of looks at each other and just goes, all right, well, I guess we're going to sing to this.
With the Prince thing, and your listeners are going to think I'm lying, whatever, that's fine. I was one of the first. Probably the first fan to know that he passed away. I have a friend of mine who works for the county where Paisley Park was, and he watched over his body and sent me a message saying Prince is dead.
So you were one of the first people to know.
In the world, yeah.
Oh, man.
If not the first.
That's incredible.
They found him in
an elevator in his house, didn't they?
Yeah, at Paisley Park, the place I work.
Where did they find him?
What he was saying makes sense, that if
the elevator
was mislabeled and he was taking something that he thought was maybe an opiate, and fentanyl is an opiate, but it's like, I don't know the breakdown, but it's almost like 100 times more powerful than, morphine.
Heroin.
It makes sense. He popped it and dropped where he was.
So he passed away on an elevator?
In an elevator by the garages. Where the cars are.
Oh.
Where they found him.
Oh, that's awful.
And it's funny about that day. When I got that message, I was short-staffed. I had people in off-site meetings. I had to wait 3 hours for them to get back to the office before I can leave. And I needed to get out of there, and I couldn't. And I just remember getting home, and I didn't go to Paisley Park. I went home first. And my wife and I just bawled because it was breaking news. And it's still hard to talk about, obviously, if you can tell by the
telephone. I remember Matt Loop. Matt Loop, who does the show sometimes whenever we do wrestling shows. He's a big wrestling fan, and we go to Comic-Con, and he's one of these Comic-Con freaks that I'll go one day, and he goes for the four-day package, you know. He owns every magazine, anything to do with Prince. He was inconsolable when he passed. You know, everybody knew that he was just going to, it was going to be like a death in the family to him, you know. And I just felt for him. I was just like, oh, fuck. And that's what got me upset, too, was I just knew how much he meant to people. And he was just some, you know, it was just, you know, I remember, you know, when I was a kid, you'd remember the songs that would kind of, you'd look at a girl and, or, you know, in the hallways and you know, the Prince tune would come on. You just kind of have that memory. And, those memories never fade. It's weird. You can't, you know, if you ask, what'd you eat the other day? It's like, I don't fucking know. But you always remember where you were whenever, it doesn't matter if it was a Prince tune or if it was a famous tune. You could remember the day, the smell, the taste, the temperature, when you first heard that tune that made you happy, that kind of made you groove, you know.
I lost my virginity to the song Erotic City.
Oh, cool.
Vito, what did you lose your virginity to? Was it like
some
the Sesame
Street? Fat chick in the woods. Did we? I don't know. What are your thoughts on Darwin's deity? Even though Michael doesn't know, what are your thoughts on him?
I've had thoughts on Darwin's deity, and I've taken him to task. He's another one of those who just read from a script, and he won't. And I've boasted that I'm an idiot. He won't debate me at all. Not that I want to debate anybody, but he won't take me down his little rabbit trail because he knows that I know his shtick.
Yeah, but Scott, you're not as stupid as you're saying. Like, when you're using my bit. I'm the stupid one. I've seen you talk. You do a good job, and you do not use huge, giant words, which I think is important for somebody like me, because I could at least follow the conversation. But you don't fall for that stuff. You don't fall for huge, you know, hubris or fucking, what's the other big word? The.
You don't gymnasium fall,
yeah,
is a big word.
Yeah, you don't fall for like stupid. But that's so cool that you just sit there and go, hey, you know, I'm not the smartest guy in the world, but I dare you to debate me. And he doesn't, because he knows
he
knows. And I've seen you say this, Darwin. You pick on the weakest guy in the room, you know, and he does. He'll try and find the weakest dude. And just go to town on this fucking guy, which I think is kind of weak in itself.
And it's really a sad existence. I mean, if that's the way you want to spend your time, then I feel bad for you. I actually feel bad.
That's cool. I do too.
Bully's got to do what bully's got to do.
Yeah, he is kind of a bully. He is a bully, but it's a weird...
There's no kind of.
Yeah, he is a bully. He is a bully. It's weird, though. But I don't want to end him on that. I want to talk about... folks, we've been talking to Scotty Too Hotty, Lawrence, who has that really cool show, Positively Godless, and keep doing that show. I really enjoy it. I love the other two, Jerry and what's the other guy's name?
Tyler.
Nice guys. But you stand out. I'm sure they're going to be pissed off, but you stand out way ahead of those guys. You absolutely, like, they need to make a podium where, you know, when you guys talk, you should be at least a foot higher. So your head is higher than theirs, and let them know.
It's funny. I'm their whipping boy, which is funny, you know, and that's kind of our thing. I have no problem with that.
I think it's wonderful because at least you got, there's a group of guys. You may not agree on everything, and I think that's important. Okay. You can't have a dick sucking show. You got to have a conversation, and that's something that either you have it or you don't. If you don't have good guests or you don't have good hosts, your show sucks. It's that simple. And I think having those two on there, it gives a great balance. And there's no bullying. I've never, ever seen you bully anybody. And if you ever want to go on that show, please do contact Lawrence. Let him know. I'll put the link at the bottom. Talk to him. I think it's so important to talk, you know, let people know what's going on. And you're honest and truthful, and you're a very sincere person. And I enjoy your time with me tonight.
Yeah, and I appreciate both of you. Thank you so much for having me on. I appreciate it.
Oh, no problem. So, folks, we've been talking to Positively Godless, Scott Lawrence. I'll put up the links. And, of course, the one and only Mykeru, Michael Cortez, the third, is here with us. Thank you so much, Michael.
Thank you.
I really appreciate it. Folks, you've been listening to the Wrecking Crew Comedy Podcast. We don't have a PayPal, but if you want to order us pizza, I mean, that would really help out. Anyways, like us. Oh, and we have the competition is coming to the end for this month. It's the Kimmy Kaboom, a 2-time Big Titty Champion. If you know the... Scott, did I ever tell you what the code word is? If you email me the code word, is Rocket Ronnie is wrong. And if you send me that, you get a month free of Kimmy Kaboom. You could see the back door of Kimmy Kaboom and 70 of her fucking gorgeous women. Big titty champion. She's an awesome woman. And you could see that. But so send me, you could win this month. And it's not a scam. You actually do win. And she's you'll love it. So email me or Facebook me.
What's the code word again?
The code word is, what the fuck is it? Rocket Ronnie is wrong. And it's not.
Oh, I love her. Yeah, I always get into her hangouts every once in a while. And she, you know, she always talks about turbines and stuff like that. It's cool.
Yeah. And it's not, we're not making fun of Rocket Ronnie like you think. We are absolutely making fun of Rocket Ronnie. So we want him.
Rocket Ronnie, she's great. She's great. Rocket Ronnie, she's great.
All right, folks. Well, you've been a blast. Be good, stay good, and stay out of trouble. Good night, gentlemen.
Night.
Peace out.